like, you're a wee boy, you're a wee boy, you're a wee boy. And just keeps doing that. And I'm like, okay, whatever. And the bouncer's getting pissed off and stuff like that.
Who is this wee boy? The bouncer is the wee boy.
So that's the thing. Like, the guy he was starting on was actually taller than this dude. Okay. So I don't know why he kept calling him a wee boy.
Okay.
The bouncer's like trying to stop him.
Yeah.
Then the guy goes to hit the bouncer, punches him in the eye. Then him and the other bouncer literally just take him outside and kick the living shit out of him.
What?
Like, literally, I mean, like, actual stomping on the guys. He hammer fists and everything. What? And then they're like, oh, this is something.
Is it like Jared Cannonier and a lumberjacker? It's that like, level of a deal.
Honestly, it's Jared Cannonier and a lumberjack outfit. Wow. And you've just said that you do not want to fight him.
And you don't want to do that. And for previous listeners of the podcast, will know that.
Yeah, exactly. You're just going to make him angry. But the funniest thing about it is, I mean, like, I shouldn't laugh at myself for this, but the guy that beat him up was actually smaller than him.
Yes.
So he was a wee boy and kicked his dick in.
Wow. So that was your night out.
That was my night out. It was something else, I'm not going to lie.
Yeah. So apart from that unfortunate incident, Edinburgh was good?
It was good, yeah. We found a really nice like vegan vegetarian place called David Ban, where the food was, pardon the pun, David Banning.
Oh, there you go. So we're gonna hit the audience with some truth here, right?
Yeah.
Today's episode was meant to be with the new FCW heavyweight champion Dickie Divers. Like yourself last night, I've just found out that he's currently experiencing traffic problems over the Forth Road Bridge.
Ah.
And he has sadly been unable to make the recording today.
Yeah, no, that is a fair point, because we did get hit by a queue of traffic just outside the Forth Road Bridge, because they announced that the Queensferry Bridge was going to be getting some maintenance done to it. They didn't say shit about the Forth Road Bridge.
Mm.
So here is us sitting there for an hour.
Yep.
Just sitting there for an hour while nothing's happening, no cars are allowed past, because a bit of an oversight. So my beloved decided to tweet a lovely message to
very far and measured and level-headed.
Very
message.
Incredibly well level-headed. There was no use of coarse language whatsoever.
They would never do that.
But it was also very effective, because 15 minutes later, the highway maintenance finally came and let us across the bridge.
That is why you don't mess with Duke Cannon and Duke Cannon's friends. Because they know who you are. They know how much of a big deal. Do you know who I am?
You know who I am. Yeah. I mean, to be fair, I'd probably be more scared of my boyfriend than I would of me. Like, oh, I'll maybe beat you up, but they'll tear you apart. They will tear your goddamn apart.
So, unfortunately, Dickie Divers has been unable to make the recording today, but we will sort this out in the future.
Yeah, we will make sure that Dickie answers for his many crimes at FCW.
Well, we'll get into that.
Yeah, we will get into that.
Because he's now kind of slighted both of us
over
the course of this year.
Over the course of the past 12 months, he has taken a toll on both of us.
Yeah. Maybe it's not a bad thing he's not here then.
Maybe, yeah.
Because get to talk to me.
Yeah!
Yeah!
Well, I mean, that's the thing. Like, we need a guest.
Yeah.
So why don't we interview yourself? Because we haven't had the chance to actually do that
yet. I'm stepping up to the plate, Duke.
Stepping up to the plate. So, for this edition of the Fierce City Wrestling Podcast, our guest is going to be Patryk Peterski.
Yeah! Yeah! You know what? It's been a lifetime ambition to be on this podcast. So I'm glad that we're finally getting to it.
We can finally make a dream come true.
That's what this is all about.
Yeah. So okay, so if that's the case, then why don't we hit you with the old five questions of doom?
And this is going to be totally off the cuff, so we'll just see what happens. Oh, see what happens when my brain comes up with.
So for context, for anyone who might be joining us for the very first time, the way that the five questions of doom work is this is a series of quick-fire interview questions, so we can get to know our guest just that a little bit better, while still leaving enough time to go into the meat of the FCW card for the next show, which is going to be on the 17th of November at the Tulloch Institute, the Fair City Zone?
Is that the Empire's Oil?
Oh, the Empire's Oil!
I picked up on this a few months ago on commentary, and John Young, who's quite often on commentary with us, coined the term Empire Zone, and I've ran with that ever since. I think it's great. Because anything can happen in the Empire Zone.
Mm.
I mean, I'm looking forward to when Cook Dannon shows up in the Empire Zone one day.
It's my nice doppelganger.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, he's a good lad.
I'm the evil twin. Okay, so yeah, let us start off with the five questions of Doom.
Yeah.
So, as always, our first question is, if you were stuck on a desert island and you had one pay-per-view that you could take with you to entertain you infinitely while you live out your life on this island like Tom Cruise in Castaway.
Mm.
Not Tom Cruise, Tom Hanks. Tom Hanks. Yeah. So, what pay-per-view would it be that you take to entertain
you? So, again, I'll say as a prefix, I've not had a lot of time to think about it. And I might have picked another one if I'd maybe had more time. But one that did come to mind straight away is WrestleMania 28.
Ooh, okay.
Maybe not a WrestleMania that somebody would go for straight away, but for lots of reasons. First of all, a very good card, I thought. A lot of big, big matches.
Mm.
Obviously, this was when we had the year-long build to Rock versus Cena 1.
Yeah.
Because as we know, WrestleMania 27 was the pre-show for WrestleMania 28.
Oh, yeah.
That was arguably the most pointless WrestleMania ever, because it was all about setting up WrestleMania 28.
Yeah. Anyway, we did jump a number ahead, essentially. Yeah.
But I remember I was still at high school at this point, and there was a group of wrestling fans at high school, and you were either Team Cena or Team Rock.
Yeah.
And this was at the height of Super Cena, as he was known, as his total domination of WWE. Just no matter who they put in front of him, he would just overcome those odds.
Yeah.
Because as he's wont to do, he was probably the best ever at that. He would just win. That's what he did. All he did was win, no matter what.
Yeah.
Got titles on his mind, etc. And it was one of them. You're thinking, oh, but it's The Rock, though. Like, surely The Rock. But if anyone could beat him, it's going to be The Rock. And again, this year-long debate in high school between me and my friends was, nah, Cena's going to win because of this, Rock's going to win because of this. And then to get that payoff that night, everyone watching it, was amazing. So that was like, then in itself, like enough to sell the card. And that's obviously what it was. It was all built around that. But for me, my favourite wrestler of all time was a Mr. Chick Magnet Punk.
Mm.
And I got to see arguably what's probably going to be his last ever match, as of this day anyway, back at All In earlier this year. So that was one ticked off the bucket list for me. This was also during his, at the time, it was the longest, turned out to be the longest WWE Championship reign for about 25 years.
Yeah.
So this is about halfway through that. He fought Chris Jericho, again, one of my favourite wrestlers of all time. So to see them two fight for a WWE Championship on WrestleMania was amazing for me. The other big match on that card was, of course, Triple H and The Undertaker.
Of course.
That was the end of an era, Hell in a Cell match. And Shawn Michaels was a special guest referee.
Yeah.
And I think we all thought for a minute when Shawn Michaels hit the super kick and Triple H hit the pedigree that that was going to be the end of the streak.
Yeah. But, I mean, like, it's one of the sort of things of, like, I remember watching that match and just thinking of, like, you know when you see something, you think, I know exactly where this is going.
Yeah. I'm thinking, there's no way Taker's beat Triple H last year, he's beat Shawn 2 years before that. Why would it be any different?
Yeah.
Even with Shawn as the ref. Because if you remember watching Raw around about that point, it wasn't as if it was, oh my God, they're going to screw Taker, because, like, this is going to be DX, like, working together. But Shawn was always, I'm going to call this down the middle. Like, I've got ultimate respect for Undertaker. And Shawn was thinking to himself, well, probably thinking to himself, because it's Shawn Michaels, well, if I couldn't beat him, then Triple H isn't going to beat him.
Yeah.
I'm better than, like, that's the eternal debate between them two, who's better. So, yeah, it wasn't like a foregone conclusion it was going to be a handicap match.
Oh, 100%. I mean, like, you could tell that was what Triple H was aiming for. Right?
Yeah.
I was just like, no.
I got my mate.
Go away. Yeah.
If you ever want a very good foray into the rivalry of Triple H and Shawn Michaels, but Triple H's career is in general, it's a great YouTube video called Wrestling Isn't Wrestling.
It just looks
as Triple H as a character throughout history, and there's a big bit of it on that match.
I've
it's very good.
Yeah, I've seen that video, and I love the impression of Randy Orton, who just goes, I'm a fucking snake. I like to hurt armed people.
You've got AEW legend Ric Flair as well appearing in that movie. Trying to explain Ric Flair to non-wrestling fans. Like, he's just an old man who's got leather skin and says woo, but trust us, he was awesome back in the day.
He's just an old goofy pervert.
So I'm now pulling up the rest of the card that I've... Oh, of course, we've forgotten about the opening match, which was the 18-second World Heavyweight title win for Sheamus over Daniel Bryan, which WWE would tell you was the start of the Yes Movement, intentionally. Probably not, but you know, everyone worked out okay in the end. We also had Kane versus Randy Orton. That wasn't great. Big Show defeating Cody Rhodes. That was also not great. The rest of the cards are a bit ropey, but under pressure of a last-minute pick, I think I've picked a card with at least three good matches that will keep me entertained on the island.
That's the thing about like most WrestleManias is that it's not about the overall card. It's not about like the card being consistently amazing. It's about the matches that mean something to you. I remember the last WrestleMania we were watching, we were at Kieran's house.
Yes. Oh, it was night two of 39, wasn't it?
Yeah, two of 39. And it was the match between Drew, Sheamus and Gunther.
That was amazing.
And I was on the edge of my seat.
Yeah.
Of just three big dudes just slapping
the meat. As Sebastian Asher likes to say.
Just slapping that meat. And it was just, it was like, compared to the other matches on the card, you know, there was ones where there was more sort of technical wrestling, there was ones where there was sort of bigger spectacle and stuff like that. But for me, that just sung to me, because it felt, you could feel the conviction in every person in that match.
Mm-hmm.
You could feel everyone be like, I am giving this my absolute all. And it shows that you don't need to have all these like super athletic moves. You don't have to have this, that, and the other. Sometimes it can just be what it is. And what it is just big guys beating the hell out of each other.
Wrestling is a variety show.
Yeah.
Even on that card, WrestleMania 28, you had a bit of that. Because you had the, what's known as like, oh, you had the quick match with Sheamus and Daniel Bryan. You had the sort of romantic side of the business. Remember, Eve Torres turned on Zack Ryder.
Yeah,
took him to Dick Kixey. But he's done all right since then.
Yeah,
maybe he'll show up in it. I mean, the one title he's not won so far is something in FCW. So
yeah,
you can't go back to WWE until he's ticked us off the list. That's how I see it.
I mean, that's what I'm saying. We are obviously the benchmark for wrestling in Scotland, possibly even the UK. So if he wants to go back to that event, he does have to come out.
You can post your pictures of like your millions of belts, but you've got the biggest tag team title in the country, don't you?
Hell yeah,
you don't need any other ones.
I don't need any other ones.
Yeah. So I'm throwing out a challenge to Matt Cardona. I don't know where they're, but here we go.
You are coming over, and we are booking you in some kind of match.
Yep.
We don't know which one yet. We'll find.
I mean, he is the deathmatch king, so it might have to be one of them.
And we're gonna have to like. Do we have a deathmatch belt?
Oh, I don't know. We do have Mr. Yuji Maki though, who likes his nursery crimes.
Oh,
I don't know if Matt Cardona's ever been in a nursery crimes match. Maybe that's a mountain for him to conquer.
See, I think we should make like a deathmatch belt where it's just like one of those cheap like child belts that you get from like a toy store. It's got nails coming out of it, but the nails are going onto the inside, and that's how you wear it to prove that you're the hardest by getting stabbed by nails.
Yes. That's the what are you willing to put yourself through to be champion?
Yeah, that's that. Like, that's how you prove that you are the hardest man in FCW, is that you wear the nail belt. And just
and there was like was it, I don't know if it was true or not, but there was that mythos around the Hardcore Championship of WWE that it was an old WWE title that was like it just been beaten to hell.
Yeah.
So we could. I'm sure the commissioner won't mind spending lots of money on a new FCW championship and one of us just to like batter it with a hammer. And then that becomes the Hardcore title. I think that'd be worth spending money on.
I mean, there is that, but also, you know, just ask for forgiveness, not for permission.
That's
we
true.
Have some belts there.
Yeah, that's true.
We can use them. But anyway, we should move on
yes.
to question number two for yourself. So question number two is, if you could form a tag team with any character, either fictional or real, who would it be?
So, I'll not reveal potential irons in the fire that I've got
Ooh.
For the future. So just watch this space for what might happen in reality. But if we're going,
are you firming that tag team with Batman?
No, I'll let Jay do that.
That's because
I don't know if you've ever heard a podcast he did with Billy Strachan a couple of years ago on the mainstream SWM podcast. Yeah. He went on a big tirade about how he thinks Batman's really boring. I don't believe him. I think he'd love to team with Batman if he gave him the chance.
I mean, something tells me that he would absolutely love to team with Batman at the drop of a hat. Yeah. There's just something about I don't know if it's the gear, or maybe it's the name or something, but something to note.
I think he was just playing it cool. And he was like, I don't actually care about Batman. He's like, he's treating him mean, keeping him keen.
Yeah. keeping Bruce Wayne on retainer.
Yeah. I'm going to go down a similar route to, I brought him up twice now, Mr. Yoon G. Market, who talked about, in an ideal world, he would have loved to have tagged with his best friend from back in the day in wrestling. That is something I would also like to do. My good friend, you've met him a couple of times, I think, now, when he's come down. We came down for WrestleMania at Night One.
Of course,
yeah. Mr. Albion De Quincey, who formerly wrestled for Combat League Wrestling up in Thurso.
Yeah.
He's taking a break from wrestling right now. I would love nothing more than to bring him down the road and team with him in FCW. We've talked about Taylor Veit before on this podcast. You had a match from a few months ago.
Yeah.
My hatred for Taylor Veit stems from Albion's first year as a wrestler. So in Combat League, they have like a house system. So it's a similar way to like New Japan with their factions.
Okay.
Basically, like everyone, you kind of need friends in New Japan, otherwise you're going to get beaten up.
Yeah.
Similarly, in Combat League, everyone's got their own house that they're in, and everyone. It's a very interesting concept of wrestling where everyone fights for points. More so than championships, and the winner at the end of the year, the winner takes the house championship. Albion was placed in a house with Taylor Veit, and forgive me, I can't remember who the third member of the house was back then. It might have been a wrestler called Lad Chapman, who's also been on the SWM podcast before, and you should check it out because he's a very, very good wrestler and a very good man as well. And it was basically, if I remember correctly, Lad was the singles wrestler. Albion was putting the tag team in the house with Taylor. Taylor was more experienced. Taylor was sort of the de facto house captain. He's going to take him under his wing, show him the ropes. This guy's totally fresh out of the training school. He's been thrown into the shows. Let's see what he can do, but let's put him with Taylor because Taylor can hopefully coach him to get some house points.
Yeah.
And I thought, great, my best friend's going into... This before I started my own journey. Albion De Quincey is also the basically the inspiration for me getting into pro wrestling as well. And I've met your lovely self, so it's turned out very well. I go up to watch his first match. Things are going very well. Albion's plugging away nicely. Albion hits his big move, which, remember Ty, what's her name? Ty Mello now, I think her name is, in AEW. Sammy Guevara's wife.
Oh, right, yeah.
Yeah. Very good wrestler as well. Mm. Brazilian girl. He borrowed her finisher, the Ty KO.
Oh, okay.
So he's got him up in like sort of a gory bomb position, almost spins him around. Smashes them in the face. Again, forgive me, I can't remember who it was he was wrestling that night. I'll need to look at. Might have been Glenn Dunbar, if I remember correctly. Another guy who's been on the podcast with Billy. Albion goes to get the cover. One, two. Taylor Veit comes in and like breaks up the pin and goes, "No, I am the captain. I am the man. I am going to get this pinfall." Tells Albion, pulls rank on Albion to get out. And then Taylor just gets rolled up and they lose the match.
Oh, Taylor's an absolute bastard, really is.
And then Taylor blames Albion. And I'm sitting there ringside going, what is going on?
I mean, as we'd expect, this is the guy that raked my eyes in order to win.
Yeah.
Like at FCW. It's... If I can describe it in one word, it's just bastard.
Yeah.
It's just, I mean, tactical bastard. Like, the guy knows what he's doing, but it doesn't mean that I approve of it.
He's so egotistical. He couldn't deal with Albion getting a pinfall victory in his first match, which is a very strange sort of position to have when you're on the same team as him, and you could argue, he could have went on an ego trip and said, look at this, like, total rookie that I've coached to victory.
Yeah, exactly.
No, he wanted to pin the opponent's shoulders to the mat himself and it ends up costing the match. A couple of months go by, they have their next show, they're teaming again. Okay, let's see if they've maybe learned from their mistakes. Very similarly, Albion's doing quite well, but unfortunately they end up coming short and they lose. What does Taylor do? He has enough and he just starts beating Albion up. And
why am I not surprised?
And he actually trades for him. He trades him out of the house, casts him out after two shows. One where Albion had the match won, the other one where, again, this rookie in the second match fortunately takes a loss, as we've all done early in our careers. And Taylor just says, nah, out you go.
Jesus Christ.
And I think that's affected Albion, low-key, the whole time. He did have a match with Taylor later in the year. It was 2 out of 3 falls. He managed to get a pin over Taylor, but he fortunately came up short 2-1 in a house championship match. And his first title shot as well. He did a great job. So he had a bit of a whirlwind year. And a lot of ups and downs for him. And Taylor was the biggest down there. And so that's why I was very passionate. If you watch the match back, you hear me on commentary. I'm trying to sort of stay as impartial as I can on most shows, as you know, because I'm a professional.
Yeah.
That one, I couldn't handle it, and that was why. And because, like I said, Albion's my best friend. He was the best man at my wedding. He's helped me through a lot of stuff in the past. He's inspired me to go into professional wrestling now. And I think it's sad that I'm now in a position where I'm now active in the business, and he's sadly not. So if I could do anything in my time in pro wrestling, I would love to team with Albion De Quincey. That's who I would like to be my fantasy tag team partner.
I mean, it's also the thing of, like, also never say never.
Yeah.
Like, we all know that a retirement in wrestling is a kind of a less of a goodbye and more of a see you later.
I mean,
like,
see you down the road.
I mean, let's be honest, how many times has Johnny Lyons retired?
Oh, he is the man, though.
That man has had more farewell tours than Kiss.
Yeah.
But, you know, the bug bites. And
so yeah, what we're saying is we're going to have, like, Ric Flair versus Johnny Lyons at No Mercy next year. That might happen.
Yeah. One of them is going to die. Yeah. We don't know who.
But yeah, that's my answer. So Albion, if you're listening, I hope you are, think about it.
Yeah, like, always keep it in the back of your mind. So let's move on to question number 3.
Yeah.
Now, this is a sort of classic question for a lot of wrestlers. Mm. If you could have a match with anyone, living or dead, who would it be? And the dead person is alive for this.
You know, it's not just an easy win.
You're not fighting a corpse.
No. I think Scully kind of brought that up, if I remember correctly.
I mean, that was a hell of a loophole. I'm going to give him some credit.
I'd go back to my earlier shout about my favorite. If I could wrestle anyone, it would be CM Punk.
That's fair.
He's got his faults. We all know this.
He's a contentious, cantankerous little man.
As do many men and women in wrestling. There's not a lot of angels out there.
Yeah, that is fair.
Again, go back to that time when I was in high school. I'd always liked wrestlers. My favourite wrestler as a kid was Eddie Guerrero. And he sadly passed away. And I went through a stage where Eddie was my guy. And it was a few years where I was like, not that I didn't like wrestlers, but I never had that same sort of connection with somebody that as I did with Eddie. Eddie was that underdog that one of the first matches I ever watched when I started religiously watching wrestling was Eddie versus Brock at No Way Out, and it was that no way is this guy going to win this match. Look at this Brock Lesnar, look at this beast, this absolute behemoth of a man. No way the wee scrappy Mexican guy is going to win. No way.
Yeah.
Eddie pulls it out. And it was one of the, well, if you'll know if you watch the match, it was one of the best reactions I think I've ever seen from any crowd ever.
I mean, yeah, that is right. It's explosive.
Yeah, and he went on to have amazing matches with, like, Kurt Angle, for example, and then he had his feud with Rey Mysterio, and tragically before he died, he was in that sort of tag team come rivalry with Batista as well, and he was just taken far too soon, and he was always my favourite. I like guys like Kurt Angle. Really, really, really liked Kurt Angle. Respect Kurt Angle. I've taken my finish from Kurt Angle, the Angle Slam. That's what I want to end my opponents with because it's such a good move. But I never really had a true favourite wrestler until CM Punk came around. Totally connected with him straight away. It was just something about him, and that was this is when he was in ECW. I've gone back and watched, like, his old Ring of Honor stuff. But my first exposure of him was the reboot of ECW.
Oh, okay, yeah.
He had his first match in the Hammerstein Ballroom against Just Incredible and just destroyed him. And this was, like, a former ECW World Heavyweight Champion.
Yeah.
So, like, yeah, it's a big deal. For those that you know, like, beating Just Incredible, ECW when it came back obviously wasn't what it was. But still, to put him in there with somebody like that, have him, like, he absolutely destroyed him.
Yeah,
he went on a tear. He ends up winning the championship the year after from Johnny Nitro. Johnny Nitro, he dropped that name. He was John Morrison then. Or it should have just been called Johnny ECW.
Johnny Dubs.
Johnny Dub. What would he want? What would his name be here? Just be Johnny.
Johnny Fair?
Johnny Fair.
Johnny Empire.
Johnny. Oh, yes! There you go, that's, Johnny Empire.
That's got.
There's another one for you, Commissioner. Get Johnny Empire in.
Yeah, like, book it, Commissioner.
Yeah.
Book it.
Yeah. Why aren't we on the booking team? We should be. Those ideas.
To be fair, I think we would rinse through all of the funds. Yeah. Let's go on a side question.
Yes.
We don't do this with everybody, but you know.
I don't have champion's advantage, but I do have side question privileges.
You do, like, you have side question privileges as one of the podcast team.
Yeah.
You get this. So, if we were on the FCW booking team, you could use the budget to book anybody to come in. Either you face them or someone else faces them, doesn't matter. But you can book one match. What do you do?
Outside of myself, we'll say, versus Ken, I'd love to see. Do you know one I would like? And this might not, you might not think of. I would like to see Daddy Ass. I'm sorry, I'm just getting
Daddy Ass.
I would like to see Daddy Ass himself. Daddy Ash, sorry. I'm tripping over myself. It's the pressure of being on this podcast. I've never been in the hot seat before. I've always been in the sort of slightly cooler seats with yourself.
I would
like to see Daddy Ash, Sebastian Asher, versus Daniel Garcia.
Ooh.
And I'll tell you for why.
Okay.
Because I know something about Sebastian Asher that not a lot of people know.
Ooh.
And I know it's something that he might not want to broadcast. Or he might not even admit to it.
Ooh, okay.
But I know that he's a bit of a mover. He likes a wee. He likes a wee dance.
Likes a wee jig, eh?
Yeah, as does Daniel Garcia. You know, a wee sort of hip thrust motion.
Are you thinking about a dance?
No, I'm not saying. I'm not saying it should be a dance off. I'm saying it should be the beginning of the match.
I mean,
that's our dominance. Maybe have special guest referee Ian Ambrose to judge the dance off.
Oh,
because he does love a dance.
He loves a dance,
but. I know, genuinely, it would also be a very good match.
I would actually watch the hell out
of that. So I'm not going to say the obvious, like, I'd like to see, like, say Gunther come in and wrestle, say Andy Roberts, like, two big heavyweights. Yeah, of course, I could say that.
Yeah.
I could say, let's get somebody like Kenny Omega to come in and wrestle Ian Ambrose, for example. Yeah. Maybe two of the best wrestlers we've got. I could say, let's get FTR versus Game On. I could say that. But I want to see Sebastian Asher dance.
You know what? I mean, that's a worthy answer right there.
Yeah.
That's definitely a worthy answer. I mean, like, you know, there's no point getting FTR versus Game On. We'd hold them in 2 seconds.
Exactly.
And that's not going to be fun for anyone. But dancing. Everyone loves dancing.
Yeah. Dancing gimmicks are over, pal.
Dancing gimmicks are over, pal. Yeah. Over like Grover.
back to CM Punk. That would be my fancy opponent. And if you're not educated on CM Punk at this point, then where have you been? You've been under a rock for the past 20 years at this point. Go and check out his documentary on the WWE Network. Obviously, there's been a lot happened since then, but it's a great review of his career up until probably about 2012, I think, when that documentary came out. There's a lot of good stuff on YouTube about him as well. And his AEW run was a lot better than a lot of people seem to remember it now because of the way it ended, but he will always be the best in the world to me.
Yeah.
So I would love to wrestle CM Punk. That would be my fantasy opponent, loving or dead.
That's fair. One of my favourite things about CM Punk was I used to listen to the Colt Cabana.
The Art of Wrestling, yeah.
Yeah, the Colt Cabana podcast a lot back in the day. And he used to like record a lot of it just in like CM Punk's spare room. And the funniest thing is, like, just every so often during an interview, you just have like CM Punk, like you could hear him like doing his dishes in the background, and they just have, like, come and chip in something and then go away again.
It's sad what's happened to them too.
Yeah.
Because obviously they were such good friends for so long, but it just shows you, nothing's guaranteed, you know, just because you've been friends with somebody for so long.
Yeah.
It is sad to see. I did see a quick one on Colt Cabana, side question privileges. We mentioned again Dickie Divers was meant to be on this podcast.
Mm-hmm.
It was a very surreal moment for me making my FCW main roster debut in that Rumble, at the Fairsight Rumble back last month.
Yeah.
I was doing all right. You were very nice and said hello to me as I was getting in the ring.
Oh, yeah, like, I didn't expect you to be coming in. Like, I just see you coming out from behind the commentary desk, like, take your trousers off and be like, ah! This is good.
There was that part of me that was like, did you just try to lull me into a false sense of security here? I was like, I'll just watch out for him. But he's been good so far.
I mean, I was trying to be nice. I went and helped Caleb Valhalla.
Yeah.
I went over and helped the mighty Caleb as he was getting his ass kicked. And then, do you know what he did? He put me in the corner and then started slapping me.
Yeah, sounds about right.
So then I just returned the favour. And then I remember there was this, like, this one kid in the audience who was like, I thought you were friends. I turned around and was like, I thought so too. But here we are, having to do this.
I know. I got in, I took out your tag partner, actually. I took out Nathan Narve. I took out the mighty Caleb. I took out Taylor Bryden. Hit a big spine buster on Spike Tierney. Things are going really well. I told Omar Muhammad that that's how you hit a spine buster. And also, Omar, I wear bucket hats better than anyone in Scottish wrestling, just for the record. I don't say I own them, I just say mine are cool.
I mean, let's be honest, he doesn't suit a bucket hat.
You maybe do. Not as well as me.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to be that guy that's like, that's my thing.
Well, I'll do that. I'll be that guy for you. That's Patrick's thing. No, bucket hats are Patrick's thing.
I said, nobody else is allowed to wear red either. Duke Cannon's thing.
Yeah. I've called that. If I see anyone wearing red.
I've seen other people wearing red tights. That's just total ripping you off.
Man. Right, where are they?
Yeah, I know, right?
Where are they?
So again, tangent, sorry. Back to what was good. It was so surreal to be not only in a match, in a Rumble match, getting childhood dreams, and doing really well, hitting these big guys.
Really well.
And then a guy who I used to go to, like Fat Sam's and in Dundee, go to the Edinburgh nightclub and watch, go to like the Garage in Glasgow and watch him wrestle for ICW. And then I turn around and I'm like, what's just happened? And I've realised that he's eliminated me from a Perth City Rumble. It was Dickie Divers. So again, that was a very surreal moment, having a guy that you've been watching wrestling for 10 years since you're a teenager. Now he's chucking you out of a match and smiling, grinning in your face and not turning up for podcasts.
Yeah. The absolute
It's not his fault. I will say that's not his fault.
It's like this one is not his fault. Yeah. So we'll give him credit for not being here, but that doesn't mean that we have to be like point or
whatever. Yeah, and there you go. Dickie Divers, SCW champion, had to sneak up from behind on me to eliminate you for a rumble.
Here's the theory.
I'll take that.
See, like, I know that there is traffic problems, but I would also say that, again, he knew that me and you were going to be in the room, and he knows that me and you have some issues with them. I'm not saying that our champions are cowards.
For the record, we're not saying that.
We are not physically saying, or literally saying, that the champion is a coward. What I am going to say is that he didn't turn up today, and also he managed to get that belt of his by cashing it in after Ian Ambrose had his ass kicked.
Yeah.
And he had a bit of assistance in the ring to do it as well. Now, I'm not going to say that he is a coward.
We're not saying that.
Not at all.
You're just pointing out what happened.
I'm just pointing out the things that have happened leading up to this.
And will we let the audience draw their own conclusions?
We will, yeah. Yes. But
what have we got next?
Well, we should go on to our next question, which is, if you could try any profession other than wrestling, what would it be?
It would have been to be a footballer, but I just wasn't good enough. At all, no, I wasn't. Well, you've never seen me play. You're not the biggest football guy in the world, but you'd watch me and you'd go, yeah, Patrick, you were never good enough. But I played Sunday League and I had fun. That would have been the dream job would have been to play professional football.
Maybe we should speak about getting like an FCW fantasy team.
I'd be up for that.
I think I don't know how much use I would be, but I
mean, I think if podcast viewers won't know this, but this has been a sort of in joke between me and myself for Duke for over a year now. And I'm one of the few guys in the training school that's into this football. But I remember one of the best reactions I ever got at a training session was when you kind of, you were being nice, you were attempting to join in on a football chat, I think me and one of the other trainees were having. And it was, we ended up bringing up Livingston Football Club, who, for those of you who know, or for those of you who don't know rather, they play their football, what was formerly known as Almond Vale Stadium, which is like the area of Livingston that it's in. It's the where the shopping centre that is. Like, but for sponsorship reasons, it is now known as the Tony Macaroni Arena. And I've never... And Duke Cannon's got an amazing laugh anyway. And when you break Duke Cannon, he will laugh uncontrollably for a solid 10 minutes.
It's like a hyena on helium.
I have never... It's great. It's one of the happiest noises in the world. But even by Duke standards, this was crazy. Like, he just went off on one.
I've fully decided now that My goal in wrestling is to hold a big show at the Tony Macaroni Arena, which I also heard has the nickname of Spaghetti Hard,
yeah.
Which is just... it's just brilliant.
When I've got a bit of spare cash, I think at the end of a season, I'm going to try and get like a Livingston shirt and get Cannon 20 on the back. Because I know for a fact you'd wear that to the ring for a match.
I would wear... I don't even watch football, but I would wear the hell out of
the whole audience would be like... thought he was from Baldur's Gate via sort of up north, but no, it turns out he's from Libby. but yeah, that's what it is. It's professional football.
I mean that's fair. Like the thing with something like football is that it's a hard thing to do, but it's also like wrestling. It's a hard thing to do, and it's especially when you've got to have like the level of conditioning that you do. I mean, like, it's kind of similar to wrestling. Like, it's just go, go, go with the cardio all the time. And you don't really get a chance to properly let up. You've always got to be on the ball at any, like, at any sort of one time.
You also have to be, there's an element of luck in it with football. Again, and this, I've no illusions that I was ever good enough. But there will be a lot of, like, good players that slip through the net because maybe the right person doesn't turn up to a training session and sees them. So you've got to, for the most part, you've got to get scouted. And there'll be a lot of world-class professional players out there off doing different things just because the right person never saw them and took them in the academy. So it would be nice to be a multi-millionaire as well, but there's time yet with wrestling.
I mean, yeah, the money side of it would be a very good thing. But again, it's the same with wrestling as well. To be on the mega bucks that somebody like Cody Rhodes is on or something, it'd be nice to live comfortably, at the very least. So that'll bring us to our final question. And this is a bit more of a philosophical one. So, Patryk Peterski, why do you wrestle?
To prove to myself that I could do it. It goes back to a bit about Albion. Albion had told me so we met in Dundee when we were both at university through football. Actually, we played on the same Sunday league team and became best friends. He moved up to Thurso when he graduated. He got a job up there. I was very sad. Had a bit of a cry because my best mate was moving to the other end of the country. Like a 6-hour drive away. 7-hour train journey because trains are really slow. And when you get past them,
there's nothing past them.
Oh, there's not, yeah. Thurso's worth going to, though. A lot of nice pubs and that. Get a good night out.
Okay.
So I was very sad. But as a good friend does, you make the effort to still go and see him and stuff. He comes down here. He's coming to the Queen Show in January, actually. Ooh, so nice. Maybe we can sort of drop the hint that, you know, there might be something here for him if he's interested. I mean, if he gets training back in again.
Yeah, it'd be real nice to see him again.
I heard that he was getting into it, and I thought, and I went and watched him for a year, and I thought, right, I need to try my hand at this now, surely, because like. It looks like he's having so much fun.
Yeah.
There's a lot of down times with Taylor. He had a bit of a run-in with Brody Adler while he was up there as well. It didn't end well for him. But there was good times as well. And with the highs he had were, I think they outweighed the lows. And it looked amazing. And obviously, wrestling fan, whole life, like a lot of us are. And I found, it was a few months before I got married, we were... up in Thurso on YouTube watching videos before Albion had one of his shows. We come across FCW Empire. And we're like, oh, that's in Perth. Advert for the school pops up halfway through. Like, well, the school's in Dundee. And he's like, you've got to do it. You've got to try it. And I'm like, yeah, you're right. I've got to do it. And then fast forward, and I said to the missus, she wasn't the missus at the time. She was in fiance at the time. Like, I've got to try this. You've seen how much fun it's been going to see Albion wrestle. I've got to try my hand at this. I don't have my football anymore because the COVID spelled the end for my Sunday league. It just folded. So I'd missed that athletic side of my life. I said, I've got to try my hand at this. And he was like, that's absolutely grand. Please do it after the wedding so you don't end up with like horrific training injury. And I'm like, yeah, that's fair. So that was the compromise. So I got married in September 22 and a few weeks later I started with Dab-Dab. And so that is why, essentially, it's the childhood dream. And I now knew that it was on my doorstep. Mm-hmm. I couldn't not do it. I'm very glad that I've chosen to do it with FCW as well. Because it's been one of the best years of my life so far. And hopefully much more good times to come.
I'm glad as well. I mean, like, I remember, like, seeing yourself and, like, a lot of the people from your intake coming up and starting for the first time. And
you were the first person I did in with in the ring as well. Don't know if you remember. We went over lockups and checked that chain. You were the first person that I ever touched inside a ring. So.
Ah, yeah. And you've touched me.
Yes, nice and soppy. We love it.
But yeah, I mean, like, it's honestly, like, seeing, like, a lot of you guys and, like, guys from your intake as well, like Hunter Redwood and Karen Douglas, and I know that, like, there's been, like, varying levels of, like, experience and stuff before coming to FCW, but seeing everyone come into their own, seeing everyone get moulded from a trainee into wrestler, being able to carry themselves, having the confidence, and knowing that they belong where they belong.
Like, the future is bright.
It's a beautiful thing to see, and I'm really happy to see just everyone coming up from our school,
yeah,
doing well, showing that they are going to be an integral part to Fair City Wrestling when the time comes, because we have a fantastic training school, we have fantastic students who all have a fantastic attitude.
Yeah.
We don't have anyone there that thinks that they're above other people or that they can treat somebody with any amount of disrespect or anything because of, like, where they are in the card. We've got a completely sort of horizontal layer when it comes to that sort of stuff. And we've also done a good job to stamp out that kind of ideology.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Again, I've thankfully been never noticed any of that at sessions or, you know, on show days and stuff like that. But certainly from DPW, Dab Dab guys. But I know for a fact if that ever was to arise, it would be rectified very quickly.
Oh, because yeah,
that's not what we're about.
It's not what we're about, and it's, again, telling people that, A, that's what we're about, but also that we're not going to put up with it. You still get people trying to throw their weight about because of, oh, I've worked X amount of years, but, you know, they have nothing to show for it. But they still think that they can treat somebody with, like, an absolute amount of disrespect.
Yeah.
And
like,
it's...
Like Karen, for example, is not just trained with Dab Dab, he's trained a couple of promotions down in the west of Scotland. Hunter Redwood, about 6 or 7 years ago, did a bit of training as well. And it's not like they came in and said, oh, well, I don't have to do this, or yeah, I don't have to go through these, like, baby steps, as you want to call them that. Like, oh, I'm this guy, I know what I'm doing. Like,
yeah.
No, it was like, yeah, okay, what's the coach want me to do?
Yeah.
You do it.
It's having the right attitude, again, not just for training, but for wrestling in general.
Yeah.
And it's good to see people coming in with that attitude. It's good to see people coming in and having each other's backs,
yeah,
and looking after them. Even some of the more nefarious members of our training school, like, we all have each other's backs. We all look after. It's that kind of thing of, like, we might mess with you, but that doesn't mean that anyone outside of us can mess with you.
Yeah. I totally get you.
Yeah.
Totally get you. Good times, man. Future's bright.
The future is...
And if you want to see that future, I know we're waiting to start plugging November's Perth show, but let's shout out January's show at the Queen's Hotel.
Yeah, yeah. Like, I think that's...
Let's sell it out, like, well in advance.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good point as well. We have a show on the, I believe it's the 27th of January?
I believe you're right. I'm going to double check it.
Which is Saturday night at the Queen's,
yep,
Hotel in Dundee. And honestly, I am,
yep,
excited for it.
Saturday 27th, 7 o'clock, £5 across the board.
So, like, you can't argue with that.
No.
£5 wrestling. In your tune.
Yep.
In your tune. And what better way to spend a Saturday night? Exactly. Not only that, Queen's Hotel, pretty central as well if you want,
mm-hmm,
to go out for a couple of drinks. A, they do have a bar, but also if you want to go out afterwards, there's plenty of pubs.
Free parking in Dundee City Centre after,
yeah,
6 o'clock.
Exactly,
you,
yeah. Like, you'd have to come up with a really good excuse as to why you can't go.
And you're going to get to see me defending my crown as the King of the
as
Class.
As the King of the
way.
Class, ooh.
And let's just say, what I've got planned for my royal entrance will be worth the £5.
Okay.
I will say nothing more than that.
Oh, I am excited.
Yeah, there you go.
Tickle
but
me.
We do have a card to plug, Duke.
We do have a card to plug, and this is for our show on the 17th of November at the Talk Institute. It is a Friday night, as always, and you can get your tickets at fcw.brent. I can say that again.
Well, because it's not the website anymore.
Oh, no, it's,
yeah,
not. Oh, that's a good thing that you caught me out there. I was about to do the usual plug. No, we have a new website.
Best thing to do is just go to the Fair City Wrestling website.
Yeah.
And there's a link there.
Yeah, it's a lot better doing that. So go to faircitywrestling.com.
And you can also see all the great work that Sarah does on the website as well.
Again, you should definitely check out the website. Sarah pours her heart and soul into that.
Real MVP of the company.
Yeah, honestly. We've given her a shout out before.
I'm happy to do it again.
And I'm happy to do it again as well, yeah. You go out, check out the website, you get all your information there, you can see everything about all your favourite wrestlers.
Yeah.
You can book tickets, you can probably order merch, I imagine. If not, then...
Well, if not, then we will now make it a thing where you can do it.
Book it, Commissioner!
Right, so the first match isn't even a match that we're going to talk about. Again, it's like, well, and cards subject to change / order will not necessarily be the same, all the usual stuff that we say.
Yep, so it is the case that the order that we go through these matches do not reflect the order that they will appear on the card.
Yeah.
The only way for you to find out what order they appear is for you to be there on the 17th of November. But yeah, we have this one to start with.
Got a moment of glory hosted by Sebastian Asher, which is, well, until very recently it was Marcus Hunter's talk show, but Sebastian's getting to host this instead. This is a bit of a prank, I think. The commissioner's pulling on Marcus just to continue the torture.
I can 100% see that. Like, don't get me wrong, I love the fact that the commissioner's back in. But this is some petty revenge, but fortunately, I'm a very petty man. Like, I'm happy for him to suffer in any way, shape, or form.
See, I thought you would have sacked him by now, but you might be thinking this is actually better. What he's doing.
I think it's a little
drawing
bit...
drawing out the pain.
Exactly, yeah.
I've offered my services on the show as the guest. The guest hasn't been announced yet.
Ooh.
He's not said if that's happening or not yet. But maybe when he finds out that I'm trying to out him as a secret, you know, dancey boy, he might not be so keen on it.
Yeah, he might try and take you on to like set you up or something.
Because
like
he takes himself very seriously. It's the Sebastian Asher.
Far too seriously.
And that's one thing I don't do. I don't think if you can't laugh at yourself, you shouldn't be able to laugh at others. But
yeah.
Those rules don't seem to apply for Sebi Boy.
Oh yeah, no, I mean,
but like I said, I've seen things that you wouldn't have wanted other people to see. I've seen him in the corner at training sessions now and again, busting a few moves, like. He's a secret dancer.
Okay, I need to...
I think he's ashamed of it. He should be ashamed of it.
I want to see this secret Babushnikov.
I mean, we're looking at the advert for the show now. Just look at his face. He takes himself far too seriously.
Yeah, he certainly does. But I mean, like, as I said, I think this is why the commissioner has put him in the place of Marcus Hunter. A, because... It puts him directly in the limelight, him directly in the square, so he can get it from all sides. But again, it's just the knowledge that he's taking his employer's spot, and the fact that the employer can do nothing about it.
Driving more of a wedge between them, I think that's what he's trying to do.
Yeah.
So for actual matches, one we've got to kick off our discussion anyway, is a grudge match, to say the least. These two... ADM has been obsessed with Caleb Valhalla ever since coming up short in his title match a few months ago.
Oh, yeah.
Where he failed to take the championship from Caleb. We saw that in the winner-take-all match at Ardlow, where, again, you came out victorious.
We came out victorious. But, I mean, like on a side note about ADM, like I still owe him one for almost tearing my leg off.
Yeah.
So for those of you that don't know, I went to go against the ropes. ADM opens them up to make sure that I fall out and tangle my leg, which was the leg that Dickie Divers made a point of kicking in.
Yeah. Clyde River Colour, eh?
Yeah,
he's got that name for a reason. But yeah, all he wanted to do that night was destroy Caleb, and I think that was partly one of the reasons that they came up short that night, because they were too focused on what their own individual goals were, whereas you were more of a team.
Well, we wanted FCW back in the hands of somebody that actually respected it, somebody who would actually use it for good. They all had their own little...
Yeah.
Their own agendas.
And the obsession continued in the Fair City Rumble. All ADM wanted to do was take out Caleb, and it's led to this. Just a big old-fashioned one-on-one, two horses going at it. ADM's looking to get revenge, like I said, for his one-on-one contest last time. But can Caleb go 2-0 against him?
You know what? I mean, I have a lot of faith in Caleb. Like, even though he did slap the hell out of me during the Rumble, I'm not forgetting about that, Caleb. I genuinely, from what I've seen, from what I've experienced being in a team with him, even just like going up against him, is that he can take on anything.
Yeah.
He is a god amongst
He's the force of Scottish wrestling right now. It's very rare that anyone's going to get the better of him, and it very rarely have in FCW. He's only got less than a handful of losses to his name. And until earlier this year, he was undefeated for years.
Yeah, and here's the thing as well. This isn't even like a knock at ADM. As much as I dislike the man as a person, I can't fault him as a wrestler.
No.
He uses his head. He knows what he's doing. I think that his only sort of downfall is maybe his pride more than anything. Like, he definitely doesn't want to be on the bottom of things. He wants to be fully on top, not having anyone sort of, what's the word? Taking his, taking his pride away from him.
I get what you're saying. I do. Speaking of pride, we have two very proud men wrestling in this next contest. Former longest reigning junior heavyweight champion, Taylor Bryden. Although Spike Tierney must be closing in on that reign soon.
Yeah, Tierney will be.
It's nearly a year that Spike's held. It was back in February, so it'll be very soon. It'll be coming up for a year.
It's been a year that Spike's been elevating that belt. Like, he's taken it and he's raised it up so much and just done incredible work with it.
As of now, the longest reigning junior heavyweight champion of all time. But he's moved up to the heavyweight division and he's taken on a proper heavyweight, as he calls himself, Andy Roberts. And he's not wrong. I've called him like a throwback wrestler before. He does the simple things probably better than anyone, and it works.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't have to be flashy.
But
he'll just hit you and hit you hard.
But it's kind of like when we're going back to what we were saying earlier about like WrestleMania, about the match between Sheamus, Drew McIntyre, and Gunther. Is that
Gunther vibes, Andy Roberts does give you that.
Oh, 100%. But it's as I say, it's like, you don't have to go in and do all these fancy, flashy moves in order to try and win. Sometimes it's just going in with your head screwed on and knowing that you can hit the other guy harder than they can hit you.
He pinned Ian Ambrose after a lariat. A move that maybe a lot of wrestling fans might think, oh, that's quite a standard move, everyone does them, but a lot of people do them. But if you're the man the size of Andy Roberts and the technique that he's got behind it, and the experience, that can take somebody's head off.
Oh yeah, there's a difference between doing a move and doing a move well.
Exactly, and like I say, he does it better than anyone.
Yeah.
And what we've always said, FCW is very good at making interesting matchups. Styles make fights. Although Taylor has moved up to heavyweight, he's still got that sort of that junior background. He's going to have to lean on that, I think, in this match.
I think he's going to have to lean on a lot, because Andy Roberts is a very, very strong competitor in FCW at the moment. So it's going to take a lot for Taylor to come out on top in this matchup with Andy. I've kind of just got to say, like, from what I've seen between the both of them in their sort of matches recently, I got to give it to Andy. I have to give it to Andy, because he's came in and he has just wrecked house. Like, it's the case of, like, fair enough, he hasn't always won, but it's not through lack of trying.
I mean, this year he's got wins over Craig Berry, John Kerr. He came up short in the 2-3 falls match against Ian Ambrose, but he did pin the champion.
He did, yeah.
So he's got a pinfall victory over Ambrose. Didn't ultimately win the match, but he's pinned some big names this year and some big men.
He put them down.
So it's a different challenge from this time against Taylor Bryan. So it'll be interesting to see how Andy adapts to that as well.
Yeah.
Now, here we go. Getting into the big boy matches now.
All right.
We've gone from a couple of big boys to big boy matches. Foundation of the Future versus Game On 3 for the FCW Tag Team Championships. Before I get your thoughts on it, I to address the elephant in the room, I'm not on by myself. Again, for those of you who maybe have seen our social medias and that over the past few days, or the DapDub media, or SCW in general, Foundation of the Future were kind enough to come down to DapDub and give us a seminar. Showed us the ropes, showed us some of their tips and tricks, and just general. Gave us a wrestling lesson. We've been very fortunate at DapDub since I've been there, just in the last year, to have the likes of Big Damo come down. We've Nitro Green kindly lent us some of his time as well. Filthy Ryan Roode as well. So, again, something that is done in the wrestling world. But I think the wrestlers like to give back every now and again. Teach trainees such as myself, kind of things they've picked up on.
Yeah.
Now, I know for a fact that you couldn't make it that day. It wasn't any malice. It wasn't like, well, I'm going to be wrestling these guys. And you're not. And I know you're not, again, you're not, the joke said, you're not that petty to think, well, I've beat these guys twice, or I don't need to learn anything from them, or I'm not going to show up just because I'm wrestling. I know you're not actually that guy. You'll learn from anyone. But they didn't take it that way. They seem to take it very personally that yourself and Nathan didn't show up. And they've used it for a bit of fuel coming into this match. So what were your thoughts on that sort of call-out, basically, from Foundation when I asked them about it?
You know, to be 100% honest, I've got to say that you're a little bit wrong on my sort of levels of pettiness.
Yeah.
Okay. You know what?
Well, maybe I've just not seen that side.
You know what? No, I'm gonna address this because this has annoyed me for far too long, and you know I haven't put out any statements. I haven't been able to see Nathan recently.
Have you been biting your tongue? I'm guessing.
Oh, I've been biting my tongue very, very hard. I wanted to speak to Nathan before sort of putting anything out or saying anything. But no, this is a good opportunity.
This is a good platform for
the thing. The thing that gets me.
Okay.
Is after the Foundation's match with
New Paradigm. Yeah, great match, by the way.
And that, you know, the whole point of that match is to find out who is going to be going against us.
Yeah.
So we go out and, you know, we're happy to see them again.
Yeah, you showed respect.
We went out, we showed respect. And you know what they did? We go for a handshake, they slap our hands away and say that it's no longer about us, it's about those titles and them getting them. Now, I understand that people say that Foundation are one of the best tag teams in the country. If you're one of the best in the country, how come we've beaten you twice? How come you can't show us any respect when we have shown you nothing but respect? And we hold the belts in that company. You are chasing us. But I'm supposed to show you respect and come along to your seminar. I'm supposed to, you know, give up my day to come and learn from people that don't even show me an ounce of the respect. I've earned those belts. We earned those belts. We worked hard to get to that position. And we're still treated like we're juveniles. I know that you've pushed us to our paces the same way that we've pushed you, but ultimately we have come out on top. And you know what? Call me cocky. Call me cocky till the cows come home. But I think we're taking those belts away. I think we are. I think we can go 3 for 3.
3 in a row.
And I hope to God that you are listening to this. I hope that Zach and Ryan are listening to every word of this. Because I mean each and every word. Not only are we going to be walking away with those belts, we're going to be walking away with your respect, whether you like it or not. Sorry,
there you go.
It's gone to me so goddamn much recently.
Sorry if that was being presumptuous about you there, but like, obviously I've not heard from you about it. Like I said, I knew you had other things on that day. I didn't. So I'm sorry if I annoyed you there.
No, it's fair. I mean, like, as it happened, I was actually quite busy that day. But when I heard it was announced, I was like, well,
you don't have to cancel your plans to go to it.
Yeah.
And then this is obviously before they made this call out to you.
Yeah.
You're feeling that. So that would obviously turn it up to a lot.
Exactly. I mean, like, when they said that, when they put out that video, that got me.
Because I was surprised after the match with Ewan and Tom that they treated you the way they did. They looked like they turned over this new leaf. They were sort of becoming better versions of themselves, being more respectful to the other tag teams in the division. And yeah, I mean, you're not wrong in saying, I've said this to you before, you hold the most prestigious tag team championships in the country. So as very good as they are, yeah, of course you can say that you're the best tag team in the country because you hold that prize. It's up to them coming and taking it away from you. Whether they can or not, history would suggest no, because you beat them twice, so why would you not beat them again?
Like, unless they can pull out some...
They're going to have to come up with a very, very different strategy.
Unless they can pull out a miracle out of the bag, they are not getting our titles. Yeah. I'm calling it now. I am calling it now with every bit of confidence, knowing that me and Nathan have went into that ring. We've defended those titles every single time against some of the best in Scotland. No one has been able to conquer us.
Yeah.
And you two, Zach and Ryan, have tried it twice and came up short each time. So I'm looking forward to that third time so we can finally put this to rest.
I don't think we need to say any more than that, do we?
Yeah.
There we go. That again, that's... I'm calling it now, again, not just saying this because you're my friend, you're my podcast host. Probably going to be match of the night.
Thanks, man. I appreciate that.
Now, speaking of matches with history, these two go even further back than yourself and the Foundation.
Oh, yes.
This goes back to pre-Fair City Wrestling, from what I've been told.
Yeah, this...
We have you and G. Mackey coming up against the returning Bochico.
The returning Bochico.
Came back at number 30 in the Rumble. Kevin Williams finally made the call. And out he came. And he nearly won the whole thing. If it wasn't for our nearly guest today, Dickie Divers.
It's everything comes back to Dickie Divers, man. Every single thing comes back to Dickie Divers.
But what an effort from Bochico. And what a great thing to see him back.
Yeah.
I mean, for those of you, he was fired from FCW. There was nothing that, although there was nothing that Marcus Hunter could do to keep him away from Dap Dub.
Oh, yeah.
So he was still around the training school. He's been putting in the work. And he's got himself in the best shape of his life.
Oh, I've seen that, yeah.
And now that he's managed to get himself back into FCW proper, I think the sky's the limit for him.
Yeah.
But he's coming up against essentially the man that gave him a shot in the business, am I right in saying, yeah? I've heard of this rejected school of luchadors that Yuen G. Mackey was once the dean of, for lack of a better term.
Yes, I mean, like, so Yuen G. Mackey has, as you probably heard from the episode that we recorded with him, he's a very eclectic man.
Yes.
He does many different things, he has many different visions and many different projects, and one of them was to take some of these down and out luchadors, the ones that would maybe never get booked or never get back, you know, the kind of runts of the litter essentially, and try and bring them up, try and teach them how to do their job. And there was quite a few of them. There was Randomico, there was Dynamico, and there was also, of course, Bochico. So Bochico owes a lot to Yuen G. Mackey. He really does. Yuen taught him, I wouldn't say he taught him everything he knows, but
he taught him the first things he would have learned.
He taught him the very basics. He taught him how to lock up, he taught him how to roll, taught him how to, you know, interact with a crowd. And Bochico has gotten just better and better over the years on his own volition. But there is always going to be that seed there that was planted by Yuen G. Mackey.
So Yuen G. Mackey sort of almost called it Dr. Frankenstein and his monster. And he's wanting to finish him off now.
Yeah.
For good.
Yeah.
So much history here. It's crazy. Like, I knew there was that sort of base layer, but then more of, I've looked into it, like, talking to yourself and stuff.
Yeah.
It's crazy how, like, deep-rooted this actually is.
Oh, yeah.
I think this is Bochico. I mean, Bochico's always been trying to prove himself because he's been seen as this afterthought. But this is the big one for him to really prove himself that he's a different man now.
Yeah.
And he's going to be a serious contender in FCW. Yeah. I think he could do it. But if you've got a gun to my head and you're asking me for a prediction, I can't see past you. As sad as that is, I think it might be too soon.
See,
for Bochico.
See, I don't know. I mean, at the same time, I've seen Bochico improving as much as he can.
Well, we both have, yeah.
And every...
But it's
every
it's
day...
It's Yuen G. Mackey. It's former FCW champion Yuen G. Mackey.
But here's the thing. Let's also remember that is former champion Yuen G. Mackey. And in order to become a former champion, you either have to give it up or you have to lose. He's not infallible. He's great. Mm. He's fantastic in so many ways. But that doesn't make you infallible.
True.
And the thing is, with how much progress Bochico has made, a lot of it might just come down to, has the student become the master?
Mm.
I mean, hell, Bochico's been out of the... Like, fair enough, he's been at Dap Dub. Mm. He's been at the training school, but we haven't seen what he's been doing in shows as well. Like, he's keeping a lot of his cards close to his chest.
Possibly deliberately.
I mean, that the thing. I think the thing that people think about Bochco is that they think that he's stupid, but that's not it at all. He is, what's the word? Farcical in a lot of ways, but I think a lot of people underestimate how switched on he is and how much he wants people to see him in a certain way.
Especially since I've joined SCW, Dub Dub, whatever. Last year, I've seen a massive change in him. And that's only been a year. But it's not the same man that I met in October last year.
I think it's easier to say that, like, Bochco is like a jester. We always think of a jester as being, like, funny and comical and, you know, just there for our amusement. But also failing to realise that jesters were well-respected members of court. They were the only people who
make fun of the king.
They were the only people that could make fun of the king. And a lot of that comes down to their intelligence as well. I want to say Bochco. It's that kind of thing. My head does say Ewan, because again, Ewan is fantastic in every way, shape and form. My brain wants to say Ewan, but my heart wants to say Bochco.
You're going with your heart.
I'm going to go with my heart on this one. I'm going to say Bochco.
I'm going with my head.
Yeah, that's fine. It's a very hard match to call.
It's a cliche at this point. What do you always say? FCW always books very interesting matchups.
We do indeed.
So we've got two very interesting matches left to talk about. Yes. Massive implications. First of all, let's talk about... Well, what do you pick? I'm flicking between them now.
Well,
what do you pick?
Let's talk about the gauntlet match.
Here we go. I believe it's the first ever gauntlet match in FCW history. It's certainly been since I've been around. You've been around since the start, I believe.
None other ones that I can think of.
Well, we've got Brody Adler, Moxie Malone, Emily Hayden, and Ashley Vega in a gauntlet match for the first ever women's Game Changer briefcase.
Yes.
Now, this was going to be a ladder match.
It was indeed, until Dickie Divers decided...
Always comes back to him.
It always comes back to Dickie Divers. Every single time, because of course he had a hissy fit at Commissioner Williams.
Yeah.
Because he wasn't in the main event, and there was this ladder match.
He's been in more ladder matches than anyone in Scotland, I believe. Yeah. So Kevin was like, yeah, okay, cool, let's bump that start up even more.
I don't think that's what he was expecting.
No.
But that's what he got.
I didn't expect the reaction from him either, if he was like, well, surely you should be happy. But he didn't seem happy.
No, he didn't seem happy at all.
But like, we'll talk about that in a minute.
Yeah.
This is still huge. Let's be honest, this is massive. Like, we've never had a female Game Changer before. And now, one of these women is going to have the chance to cash in, potentially similarly to the way the Divers did on Ambrose. But this time it will be on Serena Rose. Or whoever the champion may be in the future. Because they will have this for 1 year. Obviously, it's harder for us to predict this match because we don't know who's going in one and two.
Yeah.
Obviously, the way gauntlet matches work, for those that you don't know, the two wrestlers start in the ring. Whoever gets the first pinfall will then wrestle the third wrestler who will come out the curtain. And then that process repeats for the fourth. And then the winner, after those falls, becomes the Game Changer. Correct?
That
is a gauntlet match.
Yeah,
yeah. I've been paying attention over the years watching wrestling.
I'm glad that one of us has.
It's harder for us to say we think this wrestler will win because of this reason when we don't know what the order is going to be. But if you want any good examples of gauntlet matches, I believe SmackDown had a very sort of good series of them a few years ago when Kofi Kingston was on his road to WrestleMania.
Yeah.
If you want a feel for what those matches are like, go and try and find them on the network or go and try and find them on YouTube. Mm-hmm. You'll get a feel for what they are. They can be grueling affairs.
Oh, yeah.
Because, like, the first fall might go... could go an hour. Who knows?
Yeah.
Like, and then the winner is like, oh, great, they're through to the next round. But then they're spent. And then they've got this other competitor coming out to pick
up. Maybe three, four, maybe five people afterwards.
The strategy, but at least we know, at least the girls know that there's going to be four of them. And so their strategy is going to have to be whoever's one and two, get that first opponent out of there as quickly as possible, because you've got another two to go through. Mm-hmm. So strategy is going to be interesting.
It's going to be, and as I said, a lot of it will come down to who's going to be in what position, who's going to be starting off, who's going to be coming in near the end. It is really hard to make a prediction for this. But the competitors that we've got are all incredibly strong. We have Moxie Malone, We have
robbed of the title in the last match. Pushed Serena harder than I've seen anyone push her before. Serena had to resort to, I believe it was like chalk or dust or something that threw her in the face to like blind her because she thought she was in trouble. Never seen her like that before, Serena. Never seen that sort of unsureness of herself or ability to get it done.
Yeah, I mean I've made the comparison to Zlatan Ibrahimovic before. The fact that she can, you know, she can always talk the talk,
walk the walk.
But yeah, like that was an interesting side for her. I've never seen her have to rely on that kind of tactic in order to get by.
You've got Brody, who has never had a one-on-one. I know not the way we do things in FCW, which is fair, because you have to earn your shots. But she has never had a chance to regain the championship one-on-one since she lost it. The game changer could be a way for her to do that. So she's going to be fired up. Emily Hayden, one of the best female wrestlers in Scotland.
Oh, absolutely.
She's probably held championships in less places than she's held championships.
Yeah.
That's what she does. And you've got Ashley Vega, who's probably the future of Scottish women's wrestling.
Absolutely. Ashley Vega's just been on the...
So whoever wins, the champ's got to be watching out because they could do what her husband did to her.
Yeah. I mean, that is four incredibly strong competitors, and I'm looking forward to seeing how... like, where this goes and who ends up coming out.
Go anywhere. So, we're benching them again. Dickie Divers again. Can you see why we wanted him on this month? It would be perfect.
It's the thing of, like, he isn't even in the room with us. We've spoken about him constantly.
The inevitable Dickie Divers.
Like, we should maybe just give him, like, a FaceTime call or something like that while he's stuck in traffic.
Yep. Serena Rose on camera. I know, but she would have just... that's maybe... anyway, right. First ever ladder match in FCW history for the FCW Championship. We've got FCW Champion Dickie Divers and wrestling in the next chapter of this historic rivalry now with the infamous Ian Ambrose, the former champion. This is, in a way, it was always leading to this. These guys hated each other without the championship, and now the championship's involved. It's just turned up again, and then the ladder match has turned up again.
It's starting to be that thing of, like, it almost feels like it has to be this way.
I think this has got to be the end, surely. Because they are just going to kill each other if they keep going. We've now had... they had a match in Tayport at the start of this year. Dickie Divers totally destroyed Ambrose's leg, I believe it was.
Yeah.
And there was the ref almost threw out the contest, I remember. But Divers demand, no, I'm beating this guy. Got a pinfall victory over Ambrose. I remember you that night very gallantly stepped up to the plate.
I was raging. And said, raging.
You've injured this man. You've robbed the good people of Tayport. And we love Tayport. Hopefully we'll be back there soon. You've robbed them of a proper match. You stepped in and you fought valiantly against Divers that night. And then things seemed to simmer a wee bit. Almost like they weren't physically in contact with each other, but they're always taking jabs at each other. We finally got their last man standing match. Ambrose literally kept that away from it being a draw, but he just managed to get up to his feet. So that was 1-1 in terms of their 1-on-1 contest. Then we had the fatal four-way. Divers managed to squeeze himself into that thanks to Marcus Hunter.
Yep.
Ambrose ends up pinning him to win the championship, and now Divers cashes in on Ambrose, and it's 2-2. So this is the fifth, albeit it's the fourth one-on-one match, but it's the fifth match in their series this year.
And
who's gonna take it?
That is the
what a journey, by the way. When you think about it, when you go through it like that, it's crazy.
When you lay everything out and you see where this has all went,
realise how big it is.
It's incredible. It's something that I don't think a lot of us expected to go this hard. I mean, they're both fantastic competitors.
Two of the best in the country.
But
for all we said about Dickie Divers, he's one of the best wrestlers in the country. He is the best wrestler in the country. He's the FCW champion.
Yeah.
Let's be honest. Yeah. That's the top prize in the country.
Yeah, I can't deny that. But for me, it's the complete level of vitriol that both competitors have sort of gained for each other. It's the fact that this is went way beyond professional. Aren't two people who are competing to... they're not... well, I don't know about sort of Ian, but I don't think that Dickie was competing to get that belt to prove that he was the best, he was getting it to prove that he was better than Ian.
Yeah, nail on the head.
And I think that that's shown quite a lot in just the way that he, in the way that he wrestles, in the way that he does it. It's like, it's more that, again, he doesn't have to believe that he's the best. He just has to be better than everyone else, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Ambrose has been the target of that.
Yeah.
He's suffered for it because of it.
He genuinely has. So it's to see how personal this is. This has gone way past professionalism. This is why, like, their first proper match was the last man standing. Yeah. It's like, it's... A normal match isn't going to cut it, because it's going to go to blood and guts anyway.
Yeah.
It's going to... It's like... Well, it's
well, as you said, what Divers did, he just immediately went from, I'm not going to wrestle this man, I'm going to injure him. Yeah. Try and end his career. Because I've decided that I hate him.
Exactly. And it's that level of just... bitterness between the two of them that kind of fuels this entire thing. And like, it's at this point, I think it's safe to say it's anyone's game.
Yeah,
it's genuinely anyone's game between them two.
I don't think we even have to say that much about it, but at this point, Dickie Divers versus Dean Ambrose sells itself.
It genuinely does.
But there you go, match five.
Like,
who's, I mean, who's taking the series?
I mean, as much as like, I appreciate you saying that we'd have match of the night, I think this is going to be match of the night. I think that this is just going to be something.
This is because I've got a poncho for tag team wrestling, though. I love it. it's my own bias coming in there. It's good when it's done well, and you do it very well.
Thank you. I very much appreciate that. I very much, and I hope to do it well on the 17th. Of November at the Tulloch Institute. Make sure that you go to fearcitywrestling.com so you can get those tickets in advance, as we are expecting this one to sell big. So make sure that you are there. But I think that that kind of takes us to the end of the podcast.
That's it. Did I do okay for jumping in at the last minute?
Yeah, you did. You did fantastic. You had some great answers for the five questions of Doom. We even had a little side tangent.
Oh, yeah. And no doubt we will do this reverse for yourself, because now that I've been interviewed, it would be very rude of me not to return the favour for yourself down the line. So I'm sure when we can find out a gap in the schedule, we can get that done.
Maybe if there's another guest that pulls out, then I'll
maybe when Dickie Divers reschedules, and then... And we're not, again, we're not saying he's a coward. We're not doing that.
We're not saying that whatsoever, because that would possibly be slander or libel.
But when it happens again...
But when it happens again...
We'll do you.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, thanks very much, everyone. I think let's wrap up there. I've been Patryk Peterski. This has been one half of the SCW Tag Team Champions, the Natural 20, Duke Cannon. And we'll see you next time, yeah?
Yeah, yous have been fantastic. Thank you for tuning in. And we'll hopefully see yous there on the 17th of November. And if not, we will hopefully see yous listening to the next episode of the podcast.
Right, so tell me more about this shenanigans that was going on with Wee Boy last night.
Oh, so, right. So, he got his ass kicked by the birds.
Yeah, was he okay? Or was he in the
hospital? Oh, no, he was bleeding from his skull.
No,
literally. Like, there was a bit, because me and my boyfriend were sitting by the window. And so, like, we're getting dinner on a show. And there's a bit when this guy sort of gets up. And you know that bit in Independence Day when the scientist is, like, pressing against the glass? It was like that, bleeding from his skull.